chapter of the Gospel of John. And that again, that's the 14th chapter of the Gospel of John and the 12th verse, just one verse. That's the 14th chapter of the Gospel of John, just the 12th verse. Amen. Amen. And if you could stand to your feet, you just want to read one verse, just one verse. Just one verse. Yes. One verse. And that will form the basis of our message. Just one verse. If everyone has. In the 14th chapter of John, the Gospel of John, the 12th verse, it says, "Most assuredly I say to you, he who believes in me, the works that I do, he will do also, and greater works than these he will do, because I go to my Father." Most merciful and all-wise Father God, in the blessed name of Jesus Christ, I thank you for this great day. Father God, I thank you for your love and your tender mercies. I thank you for our great pastor, Bishop Carter, who right now is breaking bread in another vineyard. But we ask that you go there and anoint him like you are going to anoint me. Father God, don't let this word fall upon deaf ears, but let it manifest in hearts. Father God, we don't take this lightly. We thank you for this opportunity. Well, I ask right now also that you crucify this flesh, and as you put me back together again with power and authority from God, let the redeemed of the Lord say amen, 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 and amen again. I always like to set the backdrop. You may be seated. Thank you. I always like to set the backdrop with the stage, as they call it, for the word. And I always say I like to ask that you use the words of the church. And the words of the church, if you repeat them after me, is hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise him.
Praise him.
God.
God.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Those are the words of the church. If you could use them, amen, praise the Lord. If you would use them, that will help us get through this message. Is that fine? Is that okay? Because it's not fair that you hear, you feel like you want to say something, but because there's not a crowd here to make you say it, that makes God cry. It brings tears to his eyes. Because you're not praising me, you're praising what I say about you. Amen? So if you would use the words of the church, it would help us get out of here before 7 o'clock tonight, because I know minister has something to do. Amen? Because I know I have something to do. But the thing is, we all have something to do. So if you would use the words of the church, we will not be here within, I'd say, about half an hour. Is that fair now? Maybe 15, about 15. I saw some frowns out there. But we're just going to have a good time with the Lord. Is that all right? All right. Verses 1 to 3. Thank you. God bless you. Of that chapter, they say, these words are to be found. And it came to pass, when Solomon had finished building the house of God, of the Lord and the king's house, and all Solomon's desire, which he wanted to do, that the Lord appeared to Solomon the second time, as he had appeared to him at Gibeon. And the Lord said to him, I have heard your prayer, Solomon, and your supplication that you have made before me. And I have consecrated this house which you have built to put my name there forever. And my eyes and my heart will be there perpetually. Now, the reason why I believe God is speaking that to King Solomon is because there was a lot of doubting going on in the village. And in the town of Gibeon, if you know the story, they were rioting and all this littering and all this going on. And God wanted his house to come forth with power and authority. Just like this house comes forth with power and authority when our pastor brings the word of God. So, as I break this down so that you understand, God gave me the theme to use this morning, the house of God. Now, the church, if you might have heard me say this before, is the third of the four governments God has established to administer his kingdom agenda here on earth. Now, one might say, what should God's kingdom agenda look like when applied to the church? Now, we in the church need to do some careful self-examination of our agenda. one or two extremes. We describe the first extreme by the well-known charge often made against believers that we are so heavenly minded that we are no earthly good. Now, I know we heard that, but hear it in King of Kings. We're all good. Amen? And these are people who are definitely plugged into the church, but what they are plugged into, their heads never get down to their feet. So basically what I'm trying to say is that we think one thing, we do one thing, but when it comes to the God thing, we don't do it. Are you following me? Now, when we look at what God is trying to teach Solomon, it's that their faith doesn't flesh itself out in their homes, where they work, or even in their communities. So basically what I'm trying to say, church, is that we must carry ourselves, as we hear all the time from our great leader, the same way in here is the same way we carry ourselves out there. We don't veer off to the left or veer off to the right. And when we're with our friends, we don't act like them. And we love God, and they are secular. So somebody has to take a stand. Somebody has to take a precedent and know that if they're doing wrong, you must do right. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord. It doesn't make an impact for the kingdom because these people remain so insulated and isolated from the world, they never really develop relationships with believers. So even though these folks have their minds on heaven, they are of little practicality and they benefit us not in the church, but in the world. The Bible says we're supposed to be in the world, but not what? Of the world. Well, that's why we got to take a stand to know when we step outside these doors that we're living a godly life for Christ. Now, sometimes the devil will make you think that you're not living a godly life for Christ, and you're doing the best you can. That's why in the Bible it teaches us that we are only governed by what we know. And the only way we know it is through
extreme.
occurs when the church not only goes out into the world, but lets the world into the church. And that's what I'm talking about. These are persons who are so earthly minded, they are no heavenly good. And that's why I use that example. If we're going to be good teachers, good trainers, we must know how to train. We must know how to teach. But it starts where? Right here. Amen.
Thank you.
attributes of God or the preferences of God or the prerogatives of God. But since we stay in his house, and since we say we build it for him, to serve him, and since we say it is our offering and our sacrifice to him, he must give to us a sign and a signal that he will accept it as his sanctuary and designate it as a habitation for the holy. See, sometimes we get in the house of God and the leader is not of God. We ain't got to worry about that here because ours is. And then when they get in there, they are not going the wrong direction, teaching the wrong stuff. And that's why the people fall off, minister.
It does.
Now, not a church, if God is not there, and men will pray, but there will be no power if he is not there. Gold gilded organs will play, but there will be no sweetness in the notes if he is not there. Rogue choirs may sing, but the music will not saturate the soul if he is not there. Tithes and offerings may abound, but the windows of heaven will not open if he is not there. We preachers may proclaim the word, but souls will not be saved. Sinners will not be converted, and the host will be lost. The blind will not see, and the deaf will not hear if God is not there.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Holy Ghost. The church is only the church when there is an abiding confidence that's there, and six souls can find Jeremiah's bomb in Gilead, and struggling spirits can find a higher ground of heaven's tableland, and the forsaken and the forgotten can find a friend. All our sins and griefs to bear, and the word says that the disturbed and the distraught, and the, as once the one escaped every little thing, will know that they can go to the house of God in prayer. I'm talking about the house of God, children of God. And he says that the disturbed and the distraught can escape the shaking, shifting sands of a crumbling culture and stand on solid rock. See, when you come into the house of God, what he's saying, and by what I just said, is that you are on solid rock. You might have been on sinking sand, but when you come to the house of God, the rock is solid. You can hold your head up. Like the kids say, God, the devil can't touch that. But God can bless that. Amen. Let's move on. The church is only the church where the insecure and the uncertain are able to find in this place a blessed assurance and a foretaste of heaven. But I assure you that the church is not the church if he is not there. Because the presence of God is so critical and imperative and crucial to the existence of the church, and because the presence of God is so vital and necessary to the power and the permanence of the church, I wanted to share with you that which the Lord has revealed is to me is that in regard that if you don't go to church, then there is no church. That makes sense. If you don't go to church, there is no church. Because I want to tell you, the church is you. You are the church. When you walk in the doors, you bring the church in with you. And then when you sit in the pews, the word of God comes in you and sanctifies you. And when it sanctifies you, it cleans you up. And then someone said, I want to be squeaky clean. They said, there's a commercial. What is that commercial? Since I'm not going to be the whitest, what is it?
Zeth,
that's right, squeaky clean. Well, that's what happens when you come in and you take a seat and then the word of God comes out. It's just like a hose spraying water. You know, in the summertime when it's hot, you plant a garden and you spray it with water. That's what God does to us. He sprays us with the Holy Spirit sitting out there, and blood covers us. So when the enemy comes to attack us, we have our cover. Is that all right? Amen. Thank you, Lord. Now, if you have a moment, I just want to turn back the pages of history. 900 years before the birth of Christ, Solomon, as you recall, was seated on the united throne of Israel. And Solomon, by his own admission, had come to the throne when he was only a child. But somehow, through it all, God had blessed Solomon. And Solomon's reservoirs were filled with gold and silver. Now his horses were plundered by the thousands, his wives and concubines by the hundreds. He was known in the city as a man with everything. However, Solomon was not only blessed materialistically. Solomon, unlike his father David before him, was permitted to erect a temple for the living God. Now Solomon's as well. We ought to not overlook the fact that it took Solomon 7 years to erect this temple for God. Sometimes God has a way of delaying the building process until you build it the way He wants it done. So have you ever asked God for something and wondered why you haven't got it yet? That's where I'm going with this, right? Amen. You asked Him. Then we get to the point, minister, that we don't ask. We just get to the point we want to tell Him, dear God, you don't do this. Oh, you don't do that. And that's what God's talking about right now. He got mad in a sense. So sometimes God has a way of delaying the building process, as I said, until you build it the way He wants it built. Now, I don't care this morning what anyone says, God's time is not our time. Did you hear what I said? God's time is not our time. So sometimes we get impatient and we want it right now. And if we don't get it right now, we move on and we go the other direction, but we go the wrong direction. Amen? He moves by His own method. He answers only to His own alarm clock. It is hard to understand, but God still moves in a mysterious way. His wonders to perform, He plants His footsteps on the sea and rides upon the storm. So what that means is when you're going through something, God's in there with you going through it. Amen. You need to come up on that. Because all of us are going through a storm, either today, tomorrow, or you just came out of one. But His ways are not our ways, and His thoughts are not our thoughts. But then, that may be His way of saying, if it's my house, I'll build it like I want it built. Now, the record says that when Solomon had finished building the house of the Lord, when God has work for you to do, He not only appears one time, but a second time. Because greater works will build the house of God. I may as well be honest with you. If the Lord doesn't reveal Himself the first time, He will not be back for a second time. But when the Lord lays His hands on you, and when the Lord reveals His work for you, the first time He assigns you, but the second time He confirms you. The first time He gives you sight, but the second time He gives you insight. The first time He reveals His plan, but the second time He reveals His purpose. When He appeared to Moses, the first time He said, put off or take off your shoes from off thy feet, for this place wherein thou stand is holy ground. But when He appeared to Moses, the stop. your children or not. Turn around and look up to God. Not from which point your help comes. Not from which point your strength comes. He's high and lifted up. He's powerful. He's omniscient, omnipotent, omnipotent. And all I'm asking you is try the first time. Try the first time. Try the first time. Try the first time. He'll never let you down. Man will let you down every time, my sister. Every time. But he'll never let you down the first time. Amen. So would you stand to your feet? I told you 30 minutes, just 30 minutes. I told you guys. Amen. Don't take long day to get God's word out. Amen. We got things to do. God admires that. But if there's anyone here, anyone that doesn't know this man called Jesus, Mary's little baby son, God's son of man, he says in his word, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that Christ rose from the dead, then you shall be saved. Is there anyone? Is there anyone? Is there anyone? God bless you. Is there anyone that wants prayer? Any prayer request? Anything? Praise God. Is there anyone? Well, it looks like we're squeaky clean. Amen? Amen. You shall be seated.
Amen. Won't you say thank God?